that this is a vote for Rahul Gandhi ji.
He did say that.
Because any kind of psychopathy you can expect from the congressman. Okay, fine. You prove my point. Now, let's analyze the predictions which C voters has come up with. Had it not been for C voters, I would have debated the methodology, but I will grant them credibility. Now, this election is out and out just what? Here was Yediyurappa. BJP had differences with Yediyurappa on the issue of his style of functioning. There were serious allegations of corruption against him, and BJP refused. They removed him. We did not accommodate him when he wanted to come back, because we knew that our entire platform of fighting corruption would get lost. We also knew that if Yediyurappa walks away, he is going to split our votes, and that is what will cost us the state. But we took a calculated decision. We said we rather lose a state than to lose our platform for fighting corruption, because that's a major platform on which this nation needs to be aware of. Having said that, the reflection of the election is exactly that. We are minus 9%, 7% vote goes to Yediyurappa. Congress has not gained, plus 2 and with an error margin of 3. I'm not too sure. So this is not a gain for the Congress. It is that our vote has got split and we've lost. And this was a decision which was a considered decision taken by the BJP.
No, but Sudhanshu, what the exit poll reflects is there is no pan-India anti-Congress wave. There is no pan-India anti-Congress wave. This poll is reflective of that every election will be fought on a seat-by-seat, state-by-state basis.
No, this election was all about judging the performance of the BJP government in Karnataka. It was all about judging the infighting. It was all about what will be the effect of Yediyurappa when he walks away being a tall Lingayat leader. That's it. It is pure arithmetic. If I do not have the statistics right now. The number of seats which we had won within a margin of minus plus 7% comes to nearly 45 seats. So you will see when the voting results come out on the 8th, it is pure reflection of losing the 7% or 8% seats to Yediyurappa, which is the reason for our downfall. Nothing to do with the Congress.
I want to bring in one of the bright young sparks of the Congress party in Karnataka. Dinesh Gundurao is joining us on this program. Mr. Gundurao, your reflections on the exit poll numbers, and I want your sense of what sort of a government the people of Karnataka can now expect. Because we can argue about the national big picture takeaways, but people in Karnataka expect this government to be different from the past. How do we know whether the mandate that you've got, the expectations that people have, whether at all they'll be fulfilled, Mr. Gundurao?
Yeah, I think the mandate is very clear that people want good governance, people want a stable government, people want, you know, the government to do its duties fundamentally, which it's supposed to do. And I think they've just been so fed up in the last 5 years that they want, you know, somebody to really sit down, act maturely, you know, plan things out and do, you know, run the administration in an effective manner, without any partisanship or without any, you know, favor to XYZ. So I think, you know, what they want is good governance, good development, and I think Congress today in Karnataka is well placed to do that, because we've got good leaders, and even in the ticket distribution, I think they've ensured that good people are given tickets. So I think in the next 5 years, the stage is set for us to, you know, really perform and deliver to the people what they want. I think that's what.
Dinesh, you work very closely with Rahul Gandhi. We were just debating before you came along about whether this would be seen as a pro-Rahul Gandhi vote as well. How much of this Congress vote do you attribute to Rahul Gandhi coming and campaigning the number of times he did?
No, I think Rahul ji coming and Sonia ji coming really did energize the workers and, you know, gave the party, you know, a boost, and you know, it helped us to, you know, take the message which they said to the people. And even when Sonia ji came to Bangalore, she very clearly said that whatever we promised in the manifesto, we will deliver on that, and that I'm going to ensure that we'll do it. So, you know, this kind of messages really, I think, can have an impact on the people. And it really helped us, but at the same time, you know, the anti-incumbency wave was there, and the Congress party was well organized. We had not that much of internal bickering this time. And I think Rahulji did a wonderful job in, you know, ensuring accountability on ticket distribution to the local leaders. You know, so that was one thing which I think Rahulji did a very good job, where he gave the responsibility to the KPCC president and leader of opposition to really sit down and finalize the candidates. So I think, you know, overall the strategy, the way things were done and the campaign, in spite of a few pluses and minuses here, I think it was
No, but the reality also is, Ashok, and we saw it when on the Indian Express, I think there was this picture with, you know, empty seats during Mrs. Gandhi's rally, right? And even when Rahul came, the crowds were rather sparse. When Modi came and spoke, the crowds were huge. We also saw young techies just walking in, not necessarily RSS workers or BJP workers, walking in to listen to Modi in Bangalore. But none of that, the reality is, the leaders made their speeches. Not very well attended, if you look at Sonia and Rahul, very well attended for the case of Modi, but none of that really translated into votes.
Look, I don't think we can draw a conclusion either way. We can't draw a conclusion that Sonia Gandhi is completely unpopular or that Modi is popular all over the country, because we need different metrics and benchmarks for that. There is certainly a curiosity about Modi today across the country, like there was a curiosity about Sonia Gandhi when she came into politics. People wanted to come. I remember going to Haryana to a meeting where people wanted to see, you know, Indira's daughter-in-law. They may not have voted for her, but there was a curiosity about her, like there is about Modi today. But I would stick my neck out and say this was a local election where local leaders decided whether the parties won or lost. I don't think Rahul Gandhi, Sonia Gandhi or Narendra Modi were up for a referendum or up for or being tested in this election at all. Because I really don't see this as a national election.
Okay, I want just for a moment for all those viewers who've tuned in at this time to take you through what the headlines today, seawater projections are really like. And I'll ask our producers to put them out in case you've just tuned in. Let's quickly summarize where we are at this time on the headlines today exit poll. And I'll also take you through the big ticket takeaways from this poll. Let's take you through the big ticket takeaways one by one. The 10 key takeaways. The BJP set for a massive drubbing in Karnataka, losing about 50% of its seats. That is a massive loss of face for the BJP, even as it gets aggressive against the UPA at the center. Takeaway number two. The exit poll projects that there will be no hung house to Mr. Kumaraswamy, which is probably why he's not joining us on this program, will not really come into play. Neither will the JDS or the KJP. The Congress seems to be getting a majority by itself. A wafer-thin majority, maybe, but a majority nonetheless, because it is projected to pick up 114 seats. It had 80 in the last elections, gaining about 34. The big story, of course, is that B.S. Yedurappa has extracted his pound of revenge. He's picked up about 7% of the votes, and 9% of the votes have gone away from the BJP. So if you see, the BJP vote moving to Yedurappa is the biggest reason for the BJP's defeat in these elections. The Congress has increased its vote share by about 2%, but mostly it is the BJP vote share coming down which is propelling the Congress to power in Karnataka. Narendra Modi's campaign seems to have made little impact on BJP's fortunes. He campaigned in Bangalore, in Belgaum and in Mangalore, but that hasn't led to any increase. Maybe the tally would have been even lesser. We don't know. That's only in the realm of speculation. But his tally, his campaigning hasn't made a positive change for the BJP. BSY on his own has failed to make a big impact. His party projected to pick up 11 seats only. He's reduced to a marginal player, but he succeeded in his mission. His mission, he said, was to seek revenge. He succeeded in that mission. Corruption, infighting has cost the BJP there, and it is blamed for poor governance by the people of Karnataka, which is why they voted away from the BJP. The JDS's hopes of playing kingmaker are dashed. That's as far as Kumaraswamy is concerned. He campaigned really hard, traveled the state like Yedurappa did before the last elections, canvassed all across the state of Karnataka, also tactically got in a lot of the rebels, but none of that really helping him because caste played a key role and the Lingayat votes getting split. Earlier, they were dominating the BJP vote share, the Lingayat vote getting split, some going to the KJP, the rest to the BJP and some to the Congress, and therefore the Lingayats not as strongly in favor of the BJP as they were last time. And I want to focus with Shiv Vishwanathan on the importance of caste. The reality is all these issues can be spoken of, but on the ground, in Karnataka especially, caste is a key issue determining where people vote.
Now, there's two things. There are personalities who play a large, mainly party bosses and there's caste. There's a kind of interaction between the two. And the creativity of politics comes in how you channelize these larger forces. Let's not forget that this was a politics where a lot of party bosses played big roles. They were cut to size by the electoral results. But I think we have to look at the fact that there's a creativity between the two, which centers around certain issues, certain sense of moral perception, certain kinds of politics. I think it's too quick to generalize. I think what we'll see is how the local is now constructed as a national story. I'm very interested to watch that script. That script isn't available, despite Mani's presence.
You see, there is a caste angle. From what I could gather when I went to Karnataka, the Congress experimented and took a gamble. They tried to build a caste coalition without the Vokalegas and without the Lingayas, the two big castes. They put together a scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, backward caste, non-Lingayas, non-Vokalegas, and minorities, which is apparently the last person to do it for Devarajas in the 70s. So it was a gamble, it was a sort of a new form of caste coalition, and if it's worked for the Congress, one has to give it some credit. So there was certainly a strong caste angle to the team the Congress put together.
But the reality, Gauri Lankesh, also is that despite all of what the Bangalore Political Action Committee did, despite all that I picked up in Bangalore while I moved through the streets, the voters in Bangalore especially still remain apathetic towards the elections. Voting turnout in the city continue to remain. They've got high expectations from the new government, but Bangalore didn't really come out in great numbers to vote today, Gauri.
May I know what's happening, please?
Gauri? Okay, allow me to fix that audio line with Gauri in just a moment. But that is the reality. People had so many expectations from what the new government would deliver to Bangalore. But when it came to voting, they didn't show up to vote.
That's the trouble with techies. They're loud on your screen. They have strong opinions. They believe they're right. They love their own moral moral halo. But they're not participants in our democracy. They constitute a tiny segment of successful Indians. Elections are determined by unsuccessful Indians. And while 9 of your takeaways are perhaps correct, your 10th one has been wrongly written because you have failed to put in the word not. The fact of the matter is, I don't think 10% of the population of Karnataka has changed its caste since the last elections. 10% of people of all castes who voted for the BJP last time decided they wouldn't vote for the BJP this time. And the Congress party naturally has to take into account who are the dominant castes, but that does not mean that they're playing the caste card, because everyone is playing the same caste card. So up to a point, people are influenced by caste, but I think your 10th takeaway, which somehow claims without any evidence that caste has been the determining factor in this election,
You're debunking that. We're Sangvi. I want to deal with the reality that in big cities people crib, in Bangalore especially, they didn't come out to vote in great numbers.
It tends to happen more around in big cities like Bangalore and Bombay, where the elite is not necessarily the same as the majority of the people. The elite in Bombay is not necessarily Maharashtrian. The new elite, the techies he talks about, are not necessarily Kannadigas. They don't necessarily identify with the election issues. One of the criticisms the Congress had against S.M. Krishna, who to my mind was actually a very good chief minister, was that he was chief minister of Bangalore. He catered only to this constituency. There's been a shift away from the Congress and other people from catering to the concerns of these communities, which are not typical Kannadiga communities, and therefore there's, I think, less involvement in the election.
Okay, Gauri Lankesh is back with us. Gauri, we saw so much clamor for better governance in Karnataka, especially in Bangalore, but when it came to voting, Karnataka is actually ducking a national trend of voting percentages going up significantly. In Bangalore, our correspondents were saying voters didn't show up in great numbers. There was no great enthusiasm when it came to going out and casting their mandate.
Now, Karnataka is not like Tamil Nadu, where there is any wave or, you know, there's a massive switch from 60%, 70% and all that. On an average, Karnataka has polled always just about 65%. And I know that this time the Election Commission wanted to increase it to 75%. But what are the choices before the people, Rahul? If there are no good choices, then why would people come out to vote? I think that's the problem, because people have seen the corrupt Congress government, and they've kicked it out of power. They have seen a bad Janata Dal government, kicked it out of power. Now it's the BJP's turn to go. But the options before us, whether in party or candidates, are very minimal. It's really not enthusiasing any people to go to the polling booths.
But that is exactly the sense that people are trying to change. This is not, you know, just because you don't like your candidate doesn't mean you don't come out and vote. You have to send a message. We can't accept this attitude. Who wants to come in first? Yes.
So,
I think there should be nota as part of the electric voting machine, so people should be able to say that they do not agree with any of the choices of any of the parties. So then the parties will be forced to put in better candidates.
Okay.
I think, Rahul, when we get the final figures about voters turnout, and going by the trends during last couple of years, I think it will be on a higher side. It's not going to be about 60. It would be about 65. Maybe it crosses 65. And the second point about this lower voter turnout in Bangalore.
66.8% is what the voting percentages are.
Which is a couple of percentage high compared to the previous election. But I'm still sure when we get the figures on the 8th, it would be a couple of percentages more higher compared to what we are getting right now. And the other point about this lower voter turnout in Bangalore, it's not only about Bangalore. I have tried to look at the data for 2009 Lok Sabha election. Except for two or three state capitals, all the state capitals have lower turnout compared to the state average. So this is not only about Bangalore.
So people crib, but they don't vote. That's very unfortunate.
Mm-hmm. No, I think it's something more complex. I think if you look at it, the professionals of the IT industry don't understand Indian politics in the same way as those in the mining or building industry, or even ordinary people. I think you've got to understand that the intricacies of politics are not like a parent-teacher's meeting. And I think you can't reduce voting turnout. Voting turnout has been taken more seriously. Why is it that the ordinary Indian has a faith in politics, but our professionals seem to like it?
That's something to think about for everyone.
I don't think we should become a critique of the IT industry in Bangalore, because frankly, even if all the IT people are removed, you still have very few people who voted. Okay. I think there is a disconnect between Bangalore and Karnataka, or middle-class Bangalore and Karnataka, and middle-class Bombay or Mumbai and Maharashtra. The province is certainly overwhelming the city, and city governance is suffering in both those cities. But having said that, I really don't have much sympathy for people who crib all day and all year on Twitter about politics, but couldn't be bothered getting out of the house on a hot Sunday afternoon to vote. If you have two bad choices, exercise your choice.
The tweets might be a separate constituency for the election. I think that disconnect we need to explore.
The chaps on this Twitter are twits. And the people, the real human beings.
You know, you say this each time and we get into trouble.
Yeah, but that's,
why do we call Manish Ankaraiah? He says all sorts of nasty things.
Why don't they go and vote? If they did, they could throw me out. But they can't. They never will. Because they live in a universe which is completely disconnected with the reality of our country.
I want to bring in Sudhanshu Mittal. Sudhanshu, the BJP will obviously not be very happy with the results of this exit poll. You know, you would have wanted momentum to build up on your side, but it clearly shows that there is no momentum building up for the BJP. Yes, people are angry with the Congress and angry with the allegations of corruption, but there's no momentum building up towards you either.
No. Rahul, I think we are misinterpreting the entire scenario. See, this election was unique in one proposition, that this was all about BJP's Karnataka performance. In Karnataka government of BJP, we had dissidents in terms of Yedurappa who chose to walk out. We had serious allegations of corruption, which we thought we should fight, and we took a very tough stand on that. Now, having seen all this, as I told you earlier, it was a very conscious choice of BJP that we rather have a clean government than to have a government at all, because we knew that if Yedurappa walks out, he walks out with a sizable percentage of vote of the Lingayats. And this vote could itself prove to be crucial. And if you look at the projections here, this is exactly what has happened. 7% votes of BJP go to the Lingayat-dominated Karnataka Janata Party led by Yedurappa. And that's made all the difference. Congress is in gain. So this election was all about BJP and local Karnataka BJP, anything else. Well, if we had problems there, it has got reflected in the votes and it has got reflected in the mandate of people. Now, this is a serious case of introspection, that if BJP has to govern, Locally, we must manage ourselves very well. We cannot afford allegations of corruption, and we cannot afford dissidents in the party. So we need very, very tight control to ensure that the aspirations of people of Karnataka or any other state unit are met.
The other takeaway which you didn't mention is that you can't let those leaders who hold sway in Delhi but not on the ground take decisions which impact the leaders who really have a local base. In case our viewers have just tuned in, I want to take you through the Sea Voter headlines today, projections for Karnataka. As we come to an end of the first part of our program, let me take you through the numbers. And I want to take a look first at the vote share and the seat share for Karnataka. So let's begin with the projections that have been done by Sea Voter for headlines today. We're looking first at the numbers from the 2008 assembly elections to give you a sense of where things stand currently. The BJP picked up 109 seats. Let's now see what Sea Voter is projecting in this election. 114 seats for the Congress, the BJP picking up 55, the JDS picking up about 34. Now this is the projection that is being put out by Sea Voter for headlines today. This shows that the BJP, its tally is coming down by 54 seats. The Congress's tally going up by 34 seats. The JDS picking up 6 more seats over where they were. The KJP, a new entrant, picking up 11 seats. And the others picking up about 3. As far as the vote share is concerned, the BJP's vote share crashing about 9%. The Congress's vote share going up by about 2% from 35 to 37, but it is essentially the KJP, which has pulled away about 7% of the BJP vote share, which is sinking the BJP. I want to go across to Dhananjay Kumar from Mr. Yediyurappa's party. He's joining me on this program, Mr. Dhananjay Kumar. Yediyurappa wanted to be king. Some in his party said he'd at least get to be kingmaker. The reality is you ended up only seeking revenge. You've only shown to the BJP that they can't succeed without you, but you haven't been able to dent the Congress from coming to power. Mr. Dhananjay Kumar.
Rahul, this is only an estimate which you are putting forth. The reality is something different. On the 8th, when actual counting takes place, you will see that Mr. Yediyurappa himself will be the king.
No, but there's a 3% margin of error, Mr. Dhananjay Kumar. Let's be a little realistic here. Even if this vote share goes up from about 7 to 10, that's not enough to bring Mr. Yediyurappa anywhere close to Vidhan Sauda. He will still be very far away as a very marginal part of a fractured opposition.
Rahul, I am putting forth my views based on the ground reality. We have gone round the state. From constituency to constituency, I can tell you we will cross the magic number of more than 60-70, and Yediyurappa himself will be the chief minister. This you can take from me.
On the 8th, the underground reality.
All your estimates will go.
Mr. Manishankar Iyer is smirking at you and he's having a hearty laugh at your expense. Mr.
Because that's not the ground reality, it's the underground reality.
Money, I know very well. Money can always have a laugh, but money would realize on the 8th, the reality is something different. People of Karnataka would stand solidly behind Mr. Yediyurappa and Karnataka Janata Paksha.
Last word.
Do you think if the numbers, okay, let's hypothetically for a moment assume that Sea Voter has done its job properly and the numbers will hold.
Very, very brave words.
In that case, Mr. Dhananjay Kumar, would you think it would have been a big mistake for Mr. Yediyurappa to venture out all by himself? Would you then be prepared to consider moving back to the BJP if they were to ask Yediyurappa to come back?
Not at all. No question of having any truck with BJP. Suppose if it comes to that, Yediyurappa has already
declared
he would gracefully retire from public life. He would never turn back towards BJP.
Sudhanshu Mittal of the BJP has a question for you. Sudhanshu.
Rahul, very unfortunate.
What?
Rahul, there is a question of BJP asking them to come back. BJP took a conscious decision, we rather not have the government.
No, Sudhanshu,
then to have somebody
the reality, the moment the cameras go off, every leader from the BJP whom I speak to says, we can't do well in 2014 without Yedurappa. That's the reality. That's what you say off camera. Somewhere, this hypocrisy and this divergence between what you say off camera and on camera needs to end. You need to accept the reality that in Karnataka, without Yedurappa, the BJP stands no chance.
You will... No, we have suffered because of the split. No two opinions. But we took a conscious decision. We rather not have the government than to have a tainted man doing all this.
Okay, so we've come to the end of this program. I want to first get Gauri Lankesh.
Yes. After Madhukora became the chief minister, every man thinking that one MLA can become the chief minister. That is what prompted Mr. Yedurappa to float the party, knowing fully well that he will end up as being a vote katu rather than becoming the king himself. He took revenge from BJP, so be it. I'm not unhappy. I would have been unhappy that we would have compromised and had Mr. Yedurappa leading us.
Okay.
Because that would have...
We're coming to the end of this program. I want to bring in all our experts once each. I want to go across to Gauri Lankesh. With all the wisdom at your command of having covered Karnataka elections for so long, who do you think the Congress is most likely to appoint its next chief ministerial candidate?
Knowing Congress, I think its problems have begun today. Because now the leaders are going to be fighting one another, pulling each other's leg. So that's very good news, very bad news for the Congress. But if things go as planned, I think Siddaramaiah should change his hands because I think he has managed to get the Ahinda votes, which is the minorities, the backward classes, and the Dalit votes in favor of the Congress.
You didn't take a name, Gauri. You know, you're being very careful. Siddaramaiah. Okay, you said Siddaramaiah. But the reality also is, Virsanghvi, that Siddaramaiah came from the JDS. A lot of people in Karnataka say loyalty has to pay. Someone who's been in the Congress, would he be considered more acceptable than Mr. Siddaramaiah?
Well, in the Maharashtra scenario, it would be equivalent making Narayan Rane chief minister. I see that. But general takeaways from the election, I sort of agree with you that there is no overwhelming wave against the Congress. I agree with you that caste played a large part, contrary to what Mani says. And I think it's interesting the Congress, as Rook says, have built a new coalition. There are, I think, there are consequences for that in the national election. But two slightly depressing consequences and depressing takeaways. One is these results are pretty much the same as we had before the campaign started, and if these hold after the campaign was over. What this suggests, and the Congress, let's be honest, ran a very bad campaign. There was lots of infighting, there were lots of rivalries. It doesn't matter what kind of campaign you fight. It doesn't matter who goes in campaigns. People don't vote on the basis of 3 weeks. They vote on the basis of last 5 years. And the one other takeaway is that it's nice, as Sudhanshu Mittal says, to take the moral high ground, to fight, etc., and to say that we are against corruption. But the voters don't reward you for that. They defeat you.
Okay. Shiv Vishwanath.
I think this was a depressing election. Because I think to a certain extent, we didn't see any change. We saw a lot of politics, a lot of activity, but it didn't make any difference. As far as I'm concerned, to a certain extent, I think all the parties have to look at the campaigns again. Because to a certain extent, it was almost as if, despite the campaigns, politics was in suspended animation. We could have been there 5 months ago.
Mr. Iyer.
I would really like to avail of this opportunity to congratulate a man whose name has not been mentioned, G. Parameswaran, who has been recently appointed as the Congress president. I think in the circumstances, he did an outstanding job for at a time when there were giants who were vying to come into the position to answer the question that you just raised. He succeeded in maintaining an adequate amount of equilibrium within
the
Congress.
But we've also seen
party.
Vijay Bahuguna as being foisted in Uttarakhand. So even if Dr. Parameshwara is the one who worked on the ground in Karnataka.
I didn't for a moment suggest his name for chief minister. What I felt was, at this moment, I needed to pay my tribute to a low-profile Congress president who I think did an outstanding job of it and made a considerable contribution, therefore, to our victory.
He tried to keep everybody happy, tried to take them all along, and now naturally Ashok would assume that if the Congress were to project a Dalit as chief minister instead of a Mallikarjun Kharge, Dr. Parameshwara, who nationally people don't know much about, he's studied in Australia, he's a PhD,
he's an agriculture
highly
scientist.
Yes, highly educated, he would like to believe he has a good chance, but we've seen in the past the Congress doesn't necessarily look at who's strong on the ground.
Well, to be fair, Kharge is a very senior leader.
And yeah, he's also been a rather ineffectual Labour minister.
Well, a lot of people in this government, in the UPA government, have been ineffectual. Kharge is a senior politician. I would say it is between Kharge, Siddaramaiya and Parmeshwaram. Unless
no,
of
but
course,
as Veer Sanghvi said, unless you won't make Narayan Rane your chief minister in Maharashtra.
Unless the Congress, just one second, unless the Congress throws somebody, you know,
there's no
totally
comparison
different.
Between Rane and Parameshwara.
No, Siddharamaiya.
I think one factor which will play a part is that, you see, the Congress, if you look at the big business states, there's Maharashtra, there's Haryana, and there's Karnataka. These are the three states where the Congress is going to depend on to raise money for 2014 elections. So Mrs. Gandhi may place a premium on loyalty, which is where Siddaramaiya may suffer a bit, because his group in the Congress is frankly the JDS Alumni Association.
And even, yes, that's true, because even around him, if you see, it's only people from the JDS. Yes, Sanjay
C.
Kumar,
Ibrahim,
your quick takeaways, please.
Maybe, Rahul, at the moment we are not looking at any positive vote for the Congress, and we are thinking that this is just a negative vote of the BJP. And Congress is benefiting out of that. But I think with 37% vote, which Congress is expected to get, on the 8th, we might see Congress touching somewhat around 130 seats.
So you're saying the tariff could go up even further, and the pollsters are being cautious. We've seen that happen with Nitish Kumar. We've seen that happen with Mamata Banerjee. You're saying it could happen again.
So maybe on the 8th, we would say this was a wave.
And two things will happen on the 8th. The Supreme Court will decide what happens to Mr. Ashwini Kumar, and the Congress will most probably win in Karnataka, and both those things really representing the Congress's current fortunes. To all our guests for joining us on the Sea Water Headlines Today Exit Poll special program, thank you very much. It's been fascinating chatting with all of you. You've heard from all the pundits. Make what you will of the exit poll results. We'll be back on the other side of a very quick break. Thank you very much for tuning in tonight. I hope you enjoyed this program. Thank you.